Ladies and gentlemen, the Villa Park High School Jazz Ensemble, fantastic job, guys. Thank you again. I want to begin tonight's program by introducing some special guests here. We have the Richard Nixon Foundation Treasurer, John Barr, and his wife, Betty. John and Betty. The CEO of Pacific American Tile Bank, Steve Buster, and his wife, Blair. And the newly appointed director of the Richard Nixon Presidential Library and Museum, Mike Elzey. And while I have your attention, I want to take the opportunity to let you know about two good programs this month. This Sunday, March 15th, we have a celebration for Mrs. Nixon's 103rd birthday celebration, which is coincidentally shared with the Girl Scouts of America. So we'll do a free opening ceremony on the library's front steps. It's 10 a.m. till 5 p.m. And again, it's free admission all day. I encourage you to come. It'll give you the opportunity to tour the permanent galleries that are closed now. Then on Saturday, March 28th, we have Governor Mike Huckabee coming. He has a New York Times bestseller called, let me get this right here, God, Guns, Grits, and Gravy. He'll be here at 10 a.m. on March 28th. We just announced it and got a tremendous turnout. I encourage you all, if you do want to come, to go and RSVP tonight in the museum store, or you can visit nixonfoundation.org. It's real simple, and I encourage you to do it right away because we will fill up to capacity. This evening, we have a special guest to introduce our speaker. Barbara Franklin is a Richard Nixon Foundation board member and the 29th Secretary of Commerce under President George H.W. Bush. Secretary Franklin began her service as a staff assistant to public service as a staff assistant to President Nixon in 1971. She led the first White House effort to recruit women for high-level government positions, an effort that nearly quadrupled the number of women in those positions. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Secretary Barbara Franklin.
Thank you, Chris. That was very gracious. I'm thrilled to be here. I came from Washington, where, well, Washington. The atmosphere and the weather here are quite a bit better. So I'm thrilled to be here and to be able to introduce our distinguished speaker. As Chris told you, I was the staff assistant to President Nixon when he decided he wanted to advance women in the federal government, and I was the recruiter and the point person for that effort, which was very successful in terms of bringing women into jobs they had never held before, from the top ranks down through admirals, generals, tugboat captains, and the like. And I want to tell you that this would not have happened, certainly at this time, without presidential leadership. And President Nixon, in many ways, was just ahead of his time. And we should all give him accolades for that and admire his efforts on behalf of women's equality in the United States. And now to introduce our distinguished speaker. Sharyl Attkisson is an accomplished journalist with decades of experience. She's a five-time Emmy Award winner and the recipient of the Edward R. Murrow Award for Investigative Reporting. She's covered the presidencies of Bill Clinton, George W. Bush, and Barack Obama. Her work has appeared on the CBS Evening News, CBS Sunday Morning, 48 Hours, and CBS This Morning. She's one of the first journalists to fly on a military combat mission, a B-52 sortie over Kosovo. She's also brave, I would say. Her recent high-profile stories include the Fast and Furious gunwalking program, Benghazi, and the rollout of Obamacare. Again, she's very brave, I think. The Washington Post credits her as a, quote, persistent voice of news media skepticism about the government's story. Her dogged reporting during the current administration is the subject of this recently released New York Times bestseller, Stonewalled, My Fight Against the Forces of Obstruction, Intimidation, and Harassment in Obama's Washington. And she's here to talk with us about that tonight. She's a fascinating woman with a powerful message. Please welcome Sharyl Attkisson.
As you can see, I'm so excited to be here. Thank you very much for having me. My first time here at the library, and I really appreciate it. I thought I'd start by talking about government skepticism, which Barbara mentioned is kind of one of my specialties, but was not so popular the last couple of years, even among some managers and some of my colleagues, and that was really one of the biggest changes I saw in the last few years. As a journalist who's operated for 30 years in the news business, we were always taught coming up that your job is when government, corporations, special interests present a story or something they want you to report, that's not your story. You should almost consider that propaganda. The truth is not necessarily going to be contained within the four corners of a press release. That's what somebody wants you to know. Your job as a journalist, I was taught, is to find out the truth, that if something appears to be newsworthy there, dig into the facts and separate the truth from fiction and find out what's really there. That involves also asking questions and expecting answers, or continuing to ask the questions until you get the answers. Again, not such a popular thing, especially the last couple of years. As I've always said, if when you ask a politician a question, they don't answer you, and you just go away, why would they ever answer a question on any controversy? So your job as a reporter, I see it, the kind of reporting I do, is to keep at it. And when someone doesn't want to answer a question that's in the public interest, and we have a right to know, the job of journalists is to keep asking and to keep trying to find out. So that's more or less what I've tried to do for a great deal of my career, no matter what administration is in office. Sometimes the stories involved nothing political at all. Perhaps they involved charities or corporations, waste, fraud, abuse. Again, my specialty, at least in my view, was trying to put facts out there that others don't want you to have, whatever they may be. Because anybody can put facts out that everybody wants you to have and wants you to see. So again, one of the biggest differences the last couple of years that I spent at CBS was, instead of taking a press release, whether it's from the government or a corporation or special interest, and looking at it skeptically to see what news value is there and what the truth may be, we were starting to take these press information releases, what I consider in some cases propaganda, and we were reporting these uncritically as if it had to be the truth. Why? Because the government said so. And that was a huge change in my experience from, you know, everything that I'd been taught. The original investigative reporting that I had considered a specialty was not welcome by certain gatekeepers and managers that came in at CBS the last couple of years. The same kind of reporting that had been encouraged before was now largely discouraged, sort of in fits and starts. They might want a little bit of reporting on Obamacare, but as soon as the pushback from the administration and its accomplices in some of these propaganda efforts got too strong, it made certain managers uncomfortable. Instead of doing what they ought to do, in my view, stand firm and support the job that the journalists were doing, they would capitulate and they would decide maybe we didn't want to cause all that trouble and get all that pushback, not only directly from the White House, but also from Media Matters, the blog partner that it has, the other news media and quasi-news media and bloggers that cooperate and print each other's work, excuse me, in an effort to make it appear, in my view, as though there's a groundswell of opinion for or against something, when there may not be, but they can create this impression through use of social media, bloggers, and news media partners, and this administration is very good at it. One story I wanted to share that has to do with what I consider strong-arm tactics that were used more overtly by this administration than by others I experienced in the past. This story involves C-SPAN. And as I say in my book, I think most people would consider C-SPAN kind of the fairest of them all. I mean, they really don't put a lot of editorial opinion into the mix. They run, as you know, unfiltered hearings and news conferences, and they get viewpoints from all sides. But C-SPAN crossed the Obama administration fairly early on. And the way that happened was Brian Lamb, who was one of the head guys at C-SPAN, got an interview with President Obama in the Oval Office. The idea was to update a presidential documentary that C-SPAN had done and to add President Obama to it. President Obama had been in office about a year. The interview was pretty innocuous. It was maybe 8 or 9 minutes long. There wasn't a lot of news made. It was just sort of a casual interview. And Brian Lamb asked the president, "Well, I see you haven't changed the Oval Office. The decor is the same as it was for your predecessor." And the president, in his answer, implied that the reason he hadn't changed anything was, in the spirit of austerity, because the economy wasn't doing well, that he felt that it wasn't really appropriate. A couple of days later, the C-SPAN gets a call from someone at the White House. And the person at the White House says, "In a few days, you're going to read in the Washington Post a story about a multi-million dollar renovation of the Oval Office." And C-SPAN's confused, because clearly this didn't just come out of the blue. This was something they knew about all along, but seemed to directly contradict what the president had said. The White House was calling to ask that C-SPAN not air the interview when this news came out from the Washington Post. Sidebar, how interesting, isn't it, that the administration knew the Washington Post would be airing this story and when? And that's because they work with news organizations. I mean, there is good reporting done in Washington, but a lot of it is reporters who are connected. The administration will go to them and hand them a story that they want out a certain time on a certain day for a certain reason, and voila, there you have it. So they knew the Washington Post was going to have this story, and they did not want C-SPAN putting out that interview that would make it look as though the president had not been truthful or honest. Well, this posed a problem for C-SPAN, because C-SPAN maybe isn't a news organization in the traditional sense as some of the others are, but they have standards, and they felt like it would be very inappropriate to take an interview they had conducted and hold it and not put it out there when it made sense and had something to do with the news just because the White House didn't want it out there. So C-SPAN told the White House, "I don't think that we can sit on this interview." And the White House said, "Well, can't you wait until the documentary comes out in a few weeks and maybe nobody will notice, you know, the contradiction." And C-SPAN said, "I don't think we can do that." And the White House got, according to my sources, started to get heated and started to do the little bit of bullying and intimidation that they do that I know oh so well. So C-SPAN decided to take it to their board, and they had a meeting and said, "What should we do? The White House does not want us to release this interview. Here's what's going to happen. What should our position be?" And C-SPAN, rightfully so, in my opinion, decided we can't, at the request of the White House, hold an interview that was on the record on a subject that shouldn't have been particularly controversial. And how would we look if we sat on this interview when it becomes news in a couple of days and then it just sort of slips out in a couple weeks as part of the documentary and it doesn't make sense because it's not really true? We just can't do that. So C-SPAN notified the White House we're going to have to air this clip, and the White House was not happy. A couple of days later, the Washington Post comes out with a story about the multi-million dollar renovation. C-SPAN airs the clip. I don't think you noticed, I didn't notice, I don't remember this happening. It's not as though it created international headlines, but C-SPAN felt it was important to put it out there, and there it was. Well, the White House was not happy. A day or two later, the president was giving a live speech about withdrawing troops from Iraq, and a C-SPAN producer is watching this live, and his phone rings. And it's a White House official. In fact, I believe it was Josh Earnest, who's now the press secretary, but at the time was an assistant. And he's thinking to himself, the C-SPAN person, The president's on the air live. Don't these White House officials have bigger fish to fry than to be calling C-SPAN in the middle of the speech? And the guy was mad from the White House and was basically telling C-SPAN that they would pay for what they had done, that they were not happy, that this was not acceptable. They complained to other officials at C-SPAN, the White House did. They wrote emails. And one of the emails said something like, lesson learned, and implied that there would be no further cooperation with the White House and C-SPAN. That was a couple of years ago. And C-SPAN has confirmed that since then, they've received no cooperation or interviews from White House officials or the First Lady or other people of that sort. And they said this is the longest dry spell they've had since they started in the 1970s. Now, whether that's retaliation, they won't say, but I will tell you I think it is, because this is how the White House operates. That's just one anecdote that we can put in the record because we know about it. But there are many, many more instances in which the administration uses threat of access and uses sort of intimidation and bullying tactics to try to shape what news outlets do. One of the interesting things that the White House said to C-SPAN when this was going on was, no other news outlet would have done this. And I think they're right. I think that had they asked one of the other news agencies in a similar position to sit on an interview, I don't think the news agencies would have thought twice about it. I think they would have held it. I really do. And that's what's changed to me in the past few years, from a position where the media should be, and I think to a large degree used to be more independent, to a place where they don't want to upset the people that they view as being in power, the ones that can sort of hold the authority over who gets interviews with whom, what public officials appear on which television programs. There are two executives from other networks who've told me since I left CBS that they were specifically threatened that if certain stories were done or actions were taken, that they would be taken off the list of rotation for getting an interview for their morning show with certain federal officials. And this is how they try to shape what's out there. My viewpoint is all they're giving you anyway when you get the access is the propaganda they want you to have. That's really not something to be dangled out there like it's a great prize. And yet they've convinced, this is quite masterful if you think about it, they've convinced the media to act as if they have to have those interviews. We must have the propaganda first. We must have what it is that you're trying to hand out. We don't want to be skipped. So they will get the first interview with a TSA official or a transportation secretary about an initiative that they want the public to know about anyway, but they've convinced the media that it's handed out as if it's some gift or a great exclusive interview, as long as the press behaves itself and doesn't color outside the lines on certain stories. There are other tactics that I'm sure have been used by prior administrations, but I can only tell you my experience with this administration. It's been more aggressive, at least what's been directed at me. And reporters from the Washington Post, the New York Times, USA Today, the White House Correspondents Association, White House Photographers Association, have all written letters to the White House objecting to their practices, some of them in the business far longer than I, and said this is the worst White House in modern times for transparency and for openness with the press. But we're not covering it like the news story that it is. And I kind of argue we're treating it almost as if it's a family fight, something to be discussed quietly between us, but not to be exposed to the public. And I think it's much more important than that. Another example in which the media is letting itself, as I say in the book, letting our mojo slip away, our oversight responsibilities. When I was covering Fast and Furious, the Justice Department was holding a briefing one day, and I had not been able to get close to anybody on this story from the Justice Department. They wouldn't answer my questions. I couldn't get an interview with Eric Holder, the Attorney General. And they announced they were going to do an off-camera briefing at which they would give you their spin, but fair enough. You know, that's helpful to have. And I was the one at CBS covering the story and pretty much probably the one in the nation that knew the most about it, and it was appropriate for me to attend. But no sooner did I leave my office, and I had called on the way to tell the press officer that I was coming over and she would have to clear me in because I have a press pass but not a specific one that lets me into the Justice Department every day. No sooner did I leave my office did I get a call back from her, and she said, I'm not clearing you in the building, don't bother to come. So think about this. I mean, how outrageous it is that they're in essence using their authority over a federal, a public building that we own, but their authority over the security of the building they're using to keep out reporters that they don't like. And they're in essence choosing the reporters who get to cover their stories, which is outrageous. So I turn around, I come back to the office, and I tell my bureau chief, who is supportive ideologically on these issues, but I couldn't seem to get anybody to really do anything about it. I came back and told him the story, and I said, that's completely inappropriate. They can't keep reporters out, and they only wanted, in this instance, the beat reporters who are there every day to cover the stories. Those beat reporters who go to the office at the Justice Department, although they work for the networks, they tend to be closer to the officials, almost as if they work for them as a branch because their offices are there, they know all of those people, and they're less likely to ask confrontational questions, and in this case, they certainly wouldn't know the questions to ask in the same way that I did. And I shared with my bureau chief that I thought this was really important that we not let it pass, that if we started to let an administration decide what reporters can come into a building and who can cover them, it was this slippery slope, and he agreed. But he said, well, it's too late now, the press conference, you know, the briefing has started. And I could never, those last year or two at CBS, could never get anybody together as a consensus with the other bureau chiefs and other journalists to try to stop this. And if we don't stop it, I argued, it just keeps getting a little bit worse and a little bit worse. The power grab by the federal bureaucracy gets bigger and bigger. I think we could turn it around because there's power in numbers. If journalists got together, the bureau chiefs, if we reported these things that happened as news stories and if we push back against them, but there's just a lack of desire to do so. One more example that's similar to that was when I was covering Obamacare, as CBS initially assigned me to do. At some point when the website was such a mess, but you remember they brought in a contractor to fix everything and they had what they called a war room where they assured us a lot of important activity was going on and that everything would be fixed. And someone at CBS said, Sharyl, see if you can get them to let us put a camera in there and just kind of see what's going on in the war room, funded with tax dollars, doing the public's business, so we should have been allowed in. So I asked a few times different people at HHS and they never, either they didn't respond or said we couldn't get in. I've forgotten what the answer was, but it was no. And for a story that I arranged, nonetheless, on Obamacare, I arranged an interview with a technical expert who had been very critical of how the website rollout had been handled. And as I interviewed him, this was a phone interview the way it was conducted. I believe he was out west and I was on the East Coast. He was suddenly really complimentary of the Obama administration. So he went from saying in the press a couple of weeks before this was one of the worst debacles he'd ever seen, to now in the interview with me saying, they've got the best people on the job and I'm just so confident this is all gonna be better. And I said to him after we talked for a few minutes, you know, this is a huge turnaround from what you've said in the past and I'm just wondering, has something changed? And he says, oh yeah, you know, the president, the White House flew a bunch of us in, a bunch of corporate guys, technical guys, and let us see the war room. And they gave us a big tour and they showed us everything and they took us out in buses. They gave us a briefing in the Situation Room. And the goal was the White House picked key critics and key officials and wooed them and showed them the things that really the public and the press should have been shown, but showed these corporate officials that they handpicked so that they would go out and be sort of ambassadors for the cause, and they were. And this guy really did believe that they think they had things in good hands. But think about it, once again, the administration had shunned the public and the press, the people who own the information, who are paying for the effort, and kept us out, and handpicked people that don't really know, wouldn't really know the critical questions to ask, and wouldn't really have a critical way to report what's going on, guys that would then just go out and say how great everything was, and that's who they showed the effort to. So I immediately, of course, as I did being the nudge that I am, called and emailed HHS and objected. And I said, we still want to get a camera in there. It's very inappropriate for you to shut out the public and the press from this effort that we pay for and that we own, and yet invite your own hand-picked corporate executives to come in and see these things. And what really galled me is the guy that I interviewed, when I asked him certain questions, he would say, I can't tell you that. We were told not to give you these numbers that we saw on the wall, and I couldn't tell you this. So in other words, he's getting public information and being told to keep it secret from the public. It's so backwards. So once again, I went to my bureau chief, who again ideologically agreed this was outrageous, but I couldn't get any sort of organized effort behind stopping it. And I suggested that we get together with the other bureau chiefs from the networks and write a letter and object to this, because you really could put the sort of pressure on them to turn things around, but there was no stomach for anybody to do that. So little by little, I argue, we're letting our job as overseers, sort of that balance to make sure things don't get out of whack and out of control, we're letting that job go. And without us doing our oversight function, and if Congress isn't doing a great job at it, what do you have? I argue that you end up seeing on the news, and you guys know this, maybe you don't know all the reasons behind it, you end up seeing sort of an artificial reality, a view of things that people want you to see and believe, but not necessarily what's really happening. A view of press releases and propaganda and the stuff that powers that be and the administration wants you to know about for the day. Another great change, I mean, there was a time a couple of years ago when the White House every day puts out what it wants you to talk about. And there's reasons they do that. The issue may be important to them. The issue may be a way to distract from something else they don't want you to spend time on. There's all kinds of reasons that they put out their agenda of the day. But it used to be taken as sort of a suggestion. This is what the White House wants to talk about, but we don't all want to just do the same thing and put out this news. We want to report something meaningful and maybe something original. No more of that. I mean, I would hear the ground level people offer better stories, something that was really going on that mattered, and hear them be told by certain gatekeepers, well, no, the White House has this on their agenda today. We have to do story X today. So we've now let them call the shots on what's the news. I mean, the news to me shouldn't be what the government of North Korea tells its citizens is news every day, any more than that's what should happen here. But largely, we are letting people pulling the strings in positions of power tell the news media what's on the agenda every day. The last trend I want to talk about that influences what you see on the news is a tendency, not necessarily for political reasons in this case, but to just avoid pushback and headaches and to take the path of least resistance, the tendency for the press to not want original reporting on things, but to copy what it sees elsewhere. So all day long, the bosses are reading things on the Huffington Post and Slate.com and Salon.com and Media Matters and Opinion Places and Rolling Stone, and they're constantly, instead of taking the ground level reporters and producers who have good original ideas that they're working on, instead of taking those ideas, they're telling us, can you confirm what was in Politico? Can you confirm what was in the Washington Post? What about on BuzzFeed? You spend your whole day chasing somebody else's story that's already been told that may or may not be true, rather than them opening their eyes and seeing that you at the ground level are trying to offer stories that they don't want you to see. Stories that they don't want the public told about, which are more important stories in many instances. I like to say that when I was taught in journalism college coming up through the University of Florida, I was kind of taught that was plagiarism. You don't copy stories from the New York Times and the Washington Post. That was an automatic F. It's more often the norm than not, and I can tell you no good reporter or producer likes that. In fact, they hate it, because they think they have something they can bring to the table, that stories of better value and stories that are original in nature. But if the gatekeepers don't want those stories and aren't going to stand behind them and don't want to take the heat for having done the original stories, they're not going to make air. There is an entire industry now built around the pushback campaign against news organizations and reporters that dare to color outside the lines. I call it AstroTurf, and PR firms are hired by special interests and political interests now. They've mastered this game, especially the last couple of years, that if they hear you're working on a story or they've seen a line of stories that you're covering, they make sure to hire a law firm to call and start threatening and arguing. B, they get people, whether it's the administration or surrogates, to call the anchor and complain and push against it, to call the bureau chief and complain and push against it, to call the reporter. They enlist social media and Twitter, often using fake accounts on Facebook and Twitter, to talk about how the story's not true, how the reporter's not fair, to controversialize the whole thing. So now it just sounds like a controversy with some agenda rather than a factual news story. I like to say, when you hear somebody attacking those who question authority rather than questioning authority. A lot of times that's AstroTurf. They're attacking the people uncovering the story rather than looking factually at the story or addressing the issues. That's one, I think, often telltale sign. And they can flood. One person told me 50 people can easily control 500 personas on social media and make it seem as though there's a groundswell of opinion for or against an agenda or a story when there's not. But pretty soon, the news media kind of picks it up. You get the impression, if you're looking at popular news media and social media, that there's this reality that's been created by a fairly small special interest designed to make you think something. And pretty soon that becomes your reality. You see it on the news. And it makes you feel like you're an outlier when you're not. If you don't hold the opinion that you see everybody else has, boy, they said everybody thinks this. They say this is settled science. They say the debate is over on this. I didn't think it was, but something must be wrong with me. It's designed to make you feel that way. And that's why I think you can be surprised sometimes when you're seeing on the news an issue is settled, but then you talk to friends and neighbors or you do your own reading and research and you see that it's not, but you must be thinking, well, why is everybody saying so? Everybody in social media, everybody in the news media, they're treating it like this is one side of an issue and that's all there is to it. These are some of the factors that made it increasingly difficult. The last couple years I was at CBS after a wonderful career with great bosses. The last couple of years made it almost impossible for me to get any sort of original or investigative reporting on the air on almost any topic, whether it had to do with politics or charities or corporation or anything. And my producer and I just were extremely discouraged and disheartened, and I ended up asking to be let out of my contract early just because I felt there was nothing meaningful for me to do. I could have stayed there and continued to do daily stories about weather and animals and internet videos, but there's a lot of people that can do that. And I felt like after all the years I was there, that was really not my specialty nor what I wanted to do. Plus, I had never been better plugged in with sources and contacts and whistleblowers and never had to turn away so many important big stories as I did those last couple of years. And it's literally painful to get people to go out on a limb and risk their careers and their livelihoods to tell the truth about something, only to have to go back to them and say, nobody really cares after all, that your story's not going to be on television. So I departed last March, and I've been working on a freelance basis for a lot of different outlets. As long, the only qualification that I have is if they take a story that I offer, and I'm trying to do untouchable subjects that people don't want you to talk, don't want you to hear about, or the sponsors of the networks don't want you to hear about, they can't change the essence of the meaning of it. They can do normal fact-checked and editing, but they can't skew the story and tell you how it has to come out, which is something that became more the norm the last couple of years of my job that had not been the norm before. They wanted to know, they wanted to tell you how a story was going to come out in advance rather than you finding the facts and deciding where the story leads. I kind of liken it to a character. They asked you to sort of find a character to fill a role almost as if you were a casting agent, where New York would call down those last couple of years and say, do a story on X, find somebody who will say blankety blank, what this is what they want them to say, and they would actually call them characters. Find a character who will, meaning somebody who can represent a sympathetic side of whatever position they wanted you to take, and that's how the story had to come out. And I can't tell you how many reporters would call back and say, what we found on the ground is a little bit different than what you thought. Here's what's really going on. Or we couldn't find somebody to say blankety blank, but we found somebody that said something else. They either wanted the story changed to fit their preconceived notion of what they thought the story should say, or they wouldn't air it. So you had to really make a lot of compromises in your reporting, and in some cases, it meant wrestling with the idea of putting something on the air that you felt was not honest or quite true, and then you're in the position of not having anything on the air at all, not making a contribution, or putting it on the way they want it and feeling really bad about it. And a lot of reporters are struggling with that. Shortly after I left CBS, two investigative reporters left NBC, Michael Isikoff and Lisa Myers, who haven't talked publicly, but there's a new article out in New York Magazine that describes a similar process and similar roadblocks they met about the same time as I was meeting mine at CBS, almost as if there was a decision made that was against this sort of original investigative and controversial reporting They too were having trouble getting their original stories on and meeting with the same sorts of problems. So I'm a little bit pessimistic about where things stand with journalism. I think there is an appetite and room for people to watch cute pet videos and stories about the British royals, but also great investigations, great watchdog stories, and stories about your finances, waste, fraud, and abuse are always very important and popular with the public. So I'm going to let you guys ask some questions, but I feel bad every time I don't have like a positive, you know, you guys will say, ladies, well, how's it going to change and where can I go? And I don't have a great answer for that, but I feel like awareness is half the battle, knowing what's out there and what we're facing.
Sharyl, thank you for the incredible insight into your career. Thank you very much. She has agreed to ask some questions. I see some eager faces in the crowd. But our first is going to come from Maritza, who's a senior studying broadcast and television journalism at Chapman University.
Hi, thank you so much for being here tonight. My question is, as an aspiring journalist, what advice do you have to aspiring journalists, specifically investigative journalists, with your experiences and what you've gone through?
I think you face an entirely different world than I can prepare you for. And it would be easy for me to say, and I've told people in the past, stay true to yourself, keep your own standards, tell the truth, don't do things you disagree with. But I realistically know, especially from speaking at outlets where I hear them talk about what they have to report, it's a different world. And if you don't do what your bosses want to get clicks, if you work for a place that thinks it's perfectly okay for you to give your opinion and pursue an agenda, and if you don't do that, you're not going to probably keep that job very long. So there will be some wrestling with your idea of what you ought to do and your idea of what they want you to do. I do think we have the ability to push back within a certain range. You can't walk into a new job and tell your boss, go to heck, I'm not going to do it. But you have the ability to think outside the box and to push back a little bit when they ask for things that don't seem right or don't seem fair. There's a whole group of young journalists today who think, because they've expressed this to me and friends that I know and colleagues, that it's okay to pursue an agenda in a story, meaning your personal agenda, and to try to make people think the way you do rather than being open-minded and maybe pursue facts that are contrary to what you thought. I'm totally the other school of thought. I think you'll come up with better stories and more original stories if you open your mind and don't pursue an agenda, but go where the facts lead, and sometimes it'll be totally opposite of what you thought, but it will be a better story, and it will be a story that other people don't have. It's the best I can do for advice.
Our next question right here.
Hi, Sharyl. Thanks for sharing with us. I think you were more eloquent than I would be about the circumstance. And I wanted to know, I've read and heard reports, a lot of what's going on with the networks, especially the big three, they all seem to have siblings or spouses tied into the White House and the cabinet. And is that where maybe some of the leverage is coming from? Do you know much about that?
Well, it certainly doesn't help. And it's a good question. In Washington, D.C., probably a lot of you know, there are familial ties and friendships and parties and a lot of connections. Certainly that influences things. But you might be surprised to think, I don't think that's the biggest problem. That's gone on for a really long time. And while I don't think it's always appropriate, and I think it should always be disclosed when there's conflicts of interest, and it is not always disclosed. I bet it butted heads about that at CBS a couple of times as well, with disclosures I thought we ought to be making about relationships, but there was disagreement on that. But I really don't think that's the biggest problem. I think there are bigger factors that come into play and bigger influences. I don't even know them all, because those conversations don't take place in front of the reporters and producers, and nobody ever comes to you and says, here's why we don't want that story, or the story's bad. They'll usually say, that's a great story, we just don't have room for it tonight, maybe tomorrow, try again, and you start to realize when you hear the same thing over and over what they're doing, but nobody comes to you and says these things out loud. So you're left to wonder what the pressures are, and I often wondered, especially when the light switch would go off on a story that they wanted for a few weeks, but then a lot of pressure would come to bear and all of a sudden they didn't want the story. I wondered, was there something going on at a much higher level? I wondered whether sometimes news networks were concerned that regulators such as the FCC could be sent in to do things that are beyond my understanding, like limit the number of stations further that a network can own in a market, things that have to do with the business side, not so much the news side. I wonder, but don't know, if there are pressures being brought to bear that way.
Our next question to your right.
Hi, Sharyl. I've got two questions. Might as well get a bonus one in here. First, have you ever felt threatened? And the other question is, we hear all the time, the White House said, the White House said, the White House, but who is that when we hear that, the White House says? Who's that person
That's
saying
that? That's a good question. Thank you. I have been threatened, and so yes, I felt somewhat threatened, but I consider most of the people that do the bullying intimidation cowards. I don't think they're people that really typically man up and do the things that you might be afraid they might do. These are bullies and cowards, sort of like on the schoolyard, that can't hold their own, so they use their tools and their power and their authority to try to, you know, make their way and bully people. What was the second question? Oh, who are the people at the White House? I'll give you some examples. They're the press officers. So Jay Carney, when he was press secretary, used to call my bureau chief, for example, used to write emails about my stories. They would, I believe, meet a couple of times a day and divide up who was going to call, I would say harass, which news outlets, who were doing what kinds of critical reporting. This might involve some of them calling the Associated Press, which I know they did on a regular basis, some of them calling ABC, some of them calling to complain about a website headline. They kept a lot of constant pressure on in hopes that, and I think sometimes we did, we would self-censor just because it's so much trouble. Why do bosses, they just have more things to do in their day than pick up another call from White House Press Secretary Jay Carney. Their assistant press secretaries that do that work that call as well. They then work with bloggers such as Media Matters, who work, in my view, as their surrogates, and get Media Matters to start the social media blogging campaign, get them to call CBS to ask for a retraction, to say something's not true. All of a sudden, pressure's coming from all sides, from a very small vested interest group, and yet they try to make it appear as though it's a big group and it's a lot of trouble to answer and to deal with. So I think their goal is to just make it hard on anybody that does that kind of reporting so that most reasonable people would self-censor and think, I don't want to do that tomorrow. Me, when I get that kind of response, historically, I know it has meant there's usually a big story at the end of that. So that drives me. I like that. I don't mind the pushback. But it's never comfortable. Thank you. I mean, that's kind of obvious. That's what you guys would think, too, like when they're acting that apoplectic about something. But I can see from a managerial standpoint, if you're constantly answering the phone about the same couple of reporters and it's taking up all your time and it's a big headache and they're threatening not to give you good interviews for your morning show. I mentioned in the book, as far back as the Edward R. Murrow days at CBS with his boss, Fred Friendly, there were discussions about how Edward R. Murrow, why did he have to save the world every week? And that it would give them a stomach ache because they were getting pushbacks from sponsors, advertisers, and so on to the type of reporting. So that's not a new thing, but I would say it was well-perfected techniques that were tactics that were largely used by corporations in recent years, have been adopted very well and are used by the government almost as if they're private corporations to push back and stop reporting.
Next question to your far left.
Ms. Attkisson, I'd like to thank you for pushing back. And I have a kind of statement and a question, and that's a lot of guys in this room probably served in the military and have been in situations where they knew they could not win. And that's what we hear from the media or Congress, especially in Congress today, is that we can't win this fight, so we're not going to do it. But a lot of guys in our military have gone into fights knowing they probably very well may lose their life and they continue to do that, which has shaped this country. My question, you've kind of answered the media part of it. With your context, what do you see with Congress capitulating on everything that Obama wants? And we have kind of made a big victory here, but we're giving in. What are your thoughts on that? And, you know, for us sitting out here, we're always saying, what can we do? Congress and the media are the two things that can push back, and they're not, you are, but most of the media and most of Congress is not pushing back.
That's a good observation. I've spent a lot of time on Capitol Hill in the last few months, or, you know, 6 to 8 months, actually. and I hear complaints from members of Congress and staffers that sound very much like my colleagues at the networks and in print, where they say, we'd like to do more, but there's no appetite on the part of our leaders, that they really don't want us to rock the boat, or the members themselves don't want to rock the boat because it's upsetting to the leaders. I would say, this view may not be shared by everybody, but we've reached a point at which, I'm not saying there aren't great members of Congress, I'm sure there are many great members of Congress doing wonderful things, but I've also noticed that Congress acts largely now not on the basis of what individual people want them to do, but on who can get to them, what special interest and which corporate interest can get to them. They want to be on certain committees now, let's say a transportation committee, not because they really want to be heavily involved in helping the public have safe transportation, helping regulate the industry, because they want contributions from the industry that come with sitting on the committee, because the industry will contribute a lot of money to those members not to regulate them, not to hold hearings. So in this twisted sense, the very oversight committees that are supposed to do a job on our behalf have been co-opted successfully by the interests they're supposed to watch. And instead, they're acting on behalf of those interests. So many times when there is a hearing on a topic or is not a hearing on a topic, it's not because we did or didn't want it. It's because a special interest got to them, an important interest that has a lot of influence for various reasons, and convinced them this is the issue that they should or shouldn't take on. And I think that that's part of the reason you see, that we all see less done whatever, wherever you sit on the part of members of Congress sometimes than we would like.
Next question here.
First off, just a comment. Let me thank you for being a reporter and not a stenographer. But can you... can you give us your opinion, not necessarily on the political issue, but on the coverage of Hillary Clinton's email mess?
Well, that's a great question. We were just talking about this, and people will differ on how they feel. But the idea that the New York Times broke the story, I'm right about that, correct? Is that everybody's understanding? Gave permission for other liberal outlets to go ahead and do the story too. I think if a conservative outlet had broken the story, it wouldn't have been followed up, it wouldn't have been treated the same way, but because the New York Times did it, everybody's got permission, and I mean that in an informal sense, to go ahead and do the story. And it makes me wonder, just because after my experience over the last few years, I feel like so much of what is reported is being reported because certain strings are being pulled and because people want it reported. I wonder why and how the New York Times broke, and it could be exactly what it seems, that they came across information in a legitimate sense, thought it was a great story and put it out there, or it could be that somebody wants Hillary Clinton attacked in this way for some other reason, and that would explain why the liberal media outlets are jumping on board an issue that they would normally defend her on. That's how I see it. They would normally defend her on this, point out that Republicans have done it, and say that it's a non-issue, old news, and a Area 51 type conspiracy theory. But instead, they're really pursuing it, and I kind of wonder why, and I don't have the answer. That's my view.
Next question at the back of the room here.
Thank you for coming. My question is this. I go back to FDR, and from FDR up until Obama, there's never been a president in my lifetime that's on television every single day. Now, when I get up in the morning, I turn on my TV, the first thing I say to my wife is, what has Obama done to us today? It's a game we play. What has he done to us today? Because there's always something that he's doing adverse to the American people. So my question is this. I think he likes to be on television, whether it's something good or bad. He doesn't care, as long as he's on television. What would happen if Fox took a hiatus and said, we're not going to cover him? Because, for instance, when he goes on vacation, why do we need Ed Henry or somebody standing in Hawaii for 10 days, coming out and saying, well, the president came out to get a snow cone today. Who cares?
Those are really good questions. I think part of it is what we call the 24-hour news. So they're trying to kind of fill up on a given day, here's what your president is doing or is not doing or whatever it may be. But I think there are people like you who feel that way out there. Only tell us when something significant happens. Don't give him or don't give any politician sort of free rein to just be heard on any subject they want. Let's be a little choosier and look at what's newsworthy. And I can see that argument.
Our next question here in the second row.
Hi. I hear that your computer was hacked, and I wondered what the motive was and what they were looking for and who you think did it.
Thank you. Yes, despite the false reporting you may read from those characters and suspects I've mentioned, the hacking of my computer was confirmed by 3 forensics exams, also in a press release by CBS News after their forensics expert looked at both computers. And I can only tell you that my sources, including some of the forensics people, said the software that was placed in my computer and what was done to it, the CBS computer in particular, was only available to 1 of 4 federal government agencies, NSA, DIA, CIA, or FBI. And they can tell this sort of thing. And I also am told if anybody except this first expert had looked at my computer, this stuff would never have been seen. It's very high level and sophisticated, and ordinary computer people who look for malware and so on wouldn't be able to find it. You have to kind of know where to go and what to look for. And we know what date they inserted certain software. We know how it came in. For example, when I opened an email on a certain date and time, an ad popped up in the background. And even though I closed the ad, that somehow triggered the downloading a lot of the software that came into the computer. This may not be the perfect technical explanation, but this is how I understand it. And it interfered with my use of the browser that I was using. They were able to tell me retrospectively that your Firefox crashed a lot after this software went into your computer, which was true. I didn't know the software had gone on my computer. I didn't know any of this was taking place. And it happened over a period of many months. It was a long-term monitoring effort in which they'd inserted a keystroke program so they could monitor all my keystrokes. They were in the CBS News work system, which is a separate system that you have to tie into from home in addition to just getting on the regular computer. They were able to access all my email. They had all of my passwords, and in one case, my daughter's password, to things and accounts that I was using, and those were spit back at me by the forensics examiner. They were able to use, and I'm told this is not uncommon when someone has these capabilities, they were able to use Skype, my daughter's Skype account, actually, to activate it and to listen in on the audio when I didn't know that it was being used and that I was listening to. So theoretically, when I was at home interviewing confidential sources, and this is what I think they were interested in, about controversial stories that they didn't want leakers talking about, they could have heard my end of the conversation through the computer as I typed, and they could have also theoretically been listening on the telephones and pretty much had everything they needed to know about who was giving me what information. There were also classified documents found, I say planted inside my computer because I didn't put them there, and they were put in a part of the computer system that my forensics expert said you wouldn't even know existed unless you're some sort of big computer whiz, and anybody who knows me knows I'm not that person. So it was a long-term program. They looked through photographs that I and my family had. They looked through documents that we had. And I don't know the motive because nobody's come forward and said why they did it, but this was done during the same time the administration was leading its aggressive effort, which it admits to having done, against leakers in the government who were talking to members of the press about things going on inside the government, and they were trying to stop that. Or at least perhaps in my case, since this was an invisible effort they didn't want me to know about, trying to find out who was telling me what and what exactly I did or didn't know about a particular story so that they would have a heads up on where I was getting my information and what I might be about to report.
Thank you. Next question.
Okay, thank you. Sharyl, thank you for being here. A very nice presentation. You've given us a nice perspective of what it's coming from a network that is thought of as friendly towards the White House, yours, NBC, ABC. If your counterpart from Fox News was standing at that podium, what might we hear that would be different than you told us tonight?
Ask me a little bit more
about the relationship with the White House and...
Well, I think to some degree it's not as different as you might think. All the reporters on the ground, in my view, are trying to do that kind of great critical reporting. And you guys will see, if you watch cable news and clips on the web, you'll see reporters from ABC or NBC. You used to see Jake Tapper, and you'll see Jonathan Carl have good exchanges challenging obvious questionable things that the White House says. That might not be on the evening news, but you'll hear them asking the questions. The difference is, do the gatekeepers who decide what goes on television that night let those things go on the air, or do they decide those things aren't very interesting? And more often than not, at Fox, they may decide those things are interesting. So Fox might use reporters from another network asking challenging questions that you won't see their own networks carry. But I think all the ground-level reporters, I won't say all, but most of them are trying to do a great job, and they have those questions. But if your bosses are telling you, you need to get the answer to question X today, and it's not on the topic you care about, it's on the topic we care about, you have to use your one question pursuing the topic that your bosses have told you to pursue, rather than maybe what you independently think is the question to be asked.
Mm-hmm. Yes, your story about your computer being hacked is extremely disturbing, because you're really being very open about criminal activities on the part of our federal officials. And in light of that, I wonder if you could let us know where you stand on Edward Snowden at this point.
What I've said about Edward Snowden, I have friends who are in the military and who operate in secretive corners of government who really think he did a terrible thing and that he's put lives at risk. I don't know enough about that other than that they may be right. I look at Edward Snowden two ways. As I say in the book, people ask, is he a hero or is he a traitor? Is it possible that he's both? Is it possible that it depends on where you sit? He could be a hero because he revealed some important things. He revealed things that our own director of national intelligence gave false information about when testifying before Congress under oath. He revealed a lot of things the public didn't know was going on that I think if we understood more about and had reported better would be even more meaningful. And he did so, I think, from what I can tell, not that I'm a student of Edward Snowden, but at great personal peril. He took this information, whether right or wrong, and he didn't sell it, as far as we know, to foreign nations. He didn't peddle it around and try to make himself rich and, you know, sell it to spies. He went to reporters with this, and he wanted it to be made public, and he had to change, you know, as we know, his whole way of life, kind of ruin his way of life. So I think at least he thought himself as a patriot. On the other hand, if what he did endangered lives and was wrong and illegal and all of that, I suppose you could also view him as someone who did something terribly wrong too. I don't have an opinion. I don't think I know enough to draw a firm conclusion. I would just say those are those two sides to it, and I'm not sure they're mutually exclusive. I do think a lot of what he's told us is important for us to know. Some of it may be too much and that was dangerous. I don't know enough about it.
We have time for one more question. Sharyl will be available in our front lobby. She's going to be signing books and is willing to meet you all briefly. So we'll do that after this question.
Thank you, Ms. Attkisson, for being this beautiful replica of the White House. My son in eighth grade is back in Washington and learning about the Founding Fathers, an incredible country. I want to segue from what you were just commenting on, and this is whistleblowers. These are folks that put their professional careers on the line to do what's right for the country. But they don't have the deep pockets of the government, which is the taxpayer. They have to get their own legal, and a lot of times they sign settlement agreements that deny them the right to share the wrongs, and all those corrupt people stay in their positions. How do we overcome that?
I think it's tough. It's a great point. As I say in the book, poor whistleblowers, there's almost nothing for them that protects them or helps them. They're so desperate by the time they come to the press. Most of them don't like the press. They try to resolve their issues internally. Things were so bad and they feel so strongly conflicted about it. Maybe they'll talk to somebody like me. Their lives are never the same. Most of them lose their jobs. Most of them, their families are broken apart. Their finances are in upheaval. And as I say, there's no pot of gold at the end of a rainbow for them. They do this with little fanfare and thanks, and after we forget about the story, usually the thing that they exposed this is in my experience, kind of nothing happens to anybody who did that in the federal government, but those poor whistleblowers suffer the consequences the rest of their lives. One, I don't have the answer, but I'll say one irony, a case like that is John Dotson, who came forward about Fast and Furious, and he didn't lose his job at ATF, which is amazing. A sitting agent that talked to me, a news reporter on national television, and blew up this whole expose about what was going on with the government dealing arms in a foreign country, basically arming the drug cartels, hugely controversial. I think they would like to have fired him. He had some protection because he went public and because there were members of Congress like Senator Grassley helping him. But in the end, his life has been, you know, pretty much destroyed. They've tried to go after him in many different ways. They tried to, I think, find ways to prosecute him. They tried to find ways to destroy him. And he wrote a book in the last year, and CBS asked me to do just sort of a feature on his book about his experiences. And as part of that, I called the Justice Department and asked if they had a comment on some of the things that he had to say. And the funny thing is, in a real world where things are right, the Justice Department, after everything he did, should be holding him out as a hero. He should be going around and speaking to other people saying, this is what happens when someone in the federal government does something right when they see something that's wrong. Thank you, John Dotson. You helped put a stop to a program that we denied was going on, that we later had to admit that was actually killing people. Thank you. And instead, the spokesman almost spat his name out. We have no comment on John Dotson, as if he were the one that everything was his fault, not theirs. They're the ones that had told the wrong information all those years. They're the ones that had started the program, told the public and the press that the whistleblowers were liars, and yet they're holding John Dotson out as the problem. And I call it Alice in Wonderland. So they're still treating him, despite the fact they've acknowledged what happened and it should never have happened and they've done their mea culpas. Internally, he's the guy that told on them that shouldn't have done it as far as they're concerned, and that's how he's treated.
Sharyl, thank you so much. Thank you for a great opportunity.
Thank you.
Author of Stonewalled, she'll be available up in the front lobby. Please meet us up there.